This is a weird start, Ferris. Okay, well, are you ready for this?
Like, I'm ready.
Am I ready? I don't know.
I don't know. I just told you I love you and you didn't say it back. Okay. So.
Well, I love you too, Ferris.
Thank you.
Okay. No, you know what? I take that back. Well, everybody, welcome to the No Massage Show. Today's guest is Ferris Bueller from Ferris Bueller's Day Off.
Yes, that's me. Life moves pretty fast. If you don't stop and look around once in a while, you can miss it. That's a direct quote.
Yeah, that's pretty good. How long did it take you to memorize that one?
Always prepared. I think the fifth time that someone said, oh, like Ferris Bueller, I was like, I got to be locked and loaded. I got
to
be ready.
You got to have the quotes ready.
Yeah.
Definitely. Wow. That's a good one to have. It's a very famous quote from that movie.
Thank you.
Yeah. How many times have you seen that movie?
A lot. I've seen it a lot of times. I haven't seen it in the last few years, though. But
why is that?
It stuck with
me. Like, don't have the time to...
I don't know.
Commit?
I've been more focused on, I guess, different genres. I've become a little... I wouldn't say disenfranchised with 80s movies, but I did realize the other day how, like, there's a little bit of something in every 80s movie. Like, they're classics, but I don't know that I would show my kids 80s movies, like, right off the bat. Like, I watched Back to the Future with Madison's whole family, and Lily and John are, you know, very young. And it wasn't until we got halfway through that I was like, oh, there's like, you know, borderline sexual assault in this movie. This is a classic movie.
Yeah, man.
And we got to that point and I was like, oh, I didn't realize it. But it's in something like that's in pretty much every 80s movie.
For sure.
Yeah. But they're classics.
They're classics. You can't go wrong with an 80s movie. Yeah. Have you seen Revenge of the Nerds before?
I cannot say that I've seen Revenge of the Nerds because the only time that I was ever in the same room as Revenge of the Nerds was actually a time that I was horrifically drunk with my best friend middle way through college, and I was not cognizant of Revenge of the Nerds for any of that time period, so... I might have seen it, but I did not take it in.
Gotcha. It's interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah. What do you think about... I do know what you mean, though, but... And, like, also, I feel like the comedy... Just, like, the comedy in those movies is very, like, weird. It's not, like... It's very of that, like, time in history, I feel like. It's very...
Yeah, and you gotta, like... I don't know. You have to kind of know a little bit about the 80s, I feel like, to fully get it.
Yeah.
But... I don't know. It's. I mean, it worked. Yeah, obviously, it was so successful.
Our parents talk about it.
I'm still talking about it. Yeah, exactly. I wasn't even born in the 80s. So.
What's your favorite movie of all time, Ferris?
That's a tough one. Favorite movie of all time?
Favorite movie.
I don't know if I could pick a favorite of all time.
What's your favorite Hitchcock film?
Huh. All right, wait. Remind me of Hitchcock films so I can remember.
Rear Window with Cary Grant and Vertigo.
You know what?
That lady.
I think the only Hitchcock film I've seen was maybe one we watched at Pastor Paul's house that you brought up.
Lifeboat.
Lifeboat, yes.
It's a great movie.
That would be my favorite one.
Yeah, it would be the only one, too.
Because it's the only one. Yeah, exactly. It was very good, but I haven't seen a lot of Alfred Hitchcock. Did he do Birds?
Yeah.
Birds?
Mm-hmm.
Then I've seen that one as well.
Okay.
I would still probably say Lifeboat. But The Birds is good. I also just love the concept of a terrifying movie, but the villain is birds.
Mm-hmm.
So, it's great.
Yeah, man.
Yeah. How about you?
Oh, my favorite movie. I can't answer that. It's too much.
Or your favorite Hitchcock movie.
Oh, my God. Yeah. I would have to go with Lifeboat, too.
Yeah.
Lifeboat. That's just, like, a classic. It's very, like, gritty and intense and, like, claustrophobic.
Yeah.
The entire movie. It's very, a lot of stuff. There's like a Nazi, a German on the boat. So like yeah. you got that whole like suspense aspect. Yeah, that's definitely like one of my favorites. But also Rope is a very good one.
Hmm.
Where like these two students kill their professor, which every student wants to do
sure.
secretly.
Sure.
And they hide the body in this apartment and then they have like friends come over. And it's like, don't find the body. That's a whole like, you know, like suspense is like them.
Is it funny?
No.
Is it a funny movie?
It's a drama.
So it's like real life Weekend at Bernie's.
Yes. Exactly.
Nice.
Yeah, man.
Between Lifeboat and Life of Pi, mm-hmm. can we just talk about some parallels there?
Sure.
So, obviously, stuck on a boat.
Yeah.
Unlikely friends. do you think that there is a similar metaphor that runs through those wow. movies?
I've actually never seen Life of Pi.
Oh, no.
Don't judge me.
Okay. I'm not judging you, but you should totally watch it.
I should definitely watch it.
And keep Lifeboat in mind as you watch Life of Pi. I don't know that there is a metaphor that runs through both of those movies, but it's a similar circumstance, I guess.
For sure.
But I might not be remembering Lifeboat super well. That's also possible.
Yeah, maybe. Ferris, I got to ask, what's your ethnicity?
I am half Irish English. And half Lebanese.
Wow.
So my dad came to America from Lebanon when he was 17 and met my mom in a subway.
What an unlikely pair.
Yeah.
That's very interesting.
It certainly was. I don't know how they did it, how they were like, yep, this is going to work, because they're very different people. But, I mean, they're still married today. They love each other. And... you know, it worked out. So
it's a beautiful story, Ferris.
Thank you.
That's really, really heart touching.
Thank you. I'm appreciative of the way that they have done things. Yeah. They're not perfect people.
No.
Nobody is. So.
Definitely not your family. Just kidding.
Definitely not my family.
No, I'm kidding.
Obviously.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No.
How about you?
Oh, my parents?
Yeah.
Oh, my dad met my mom working at a deli. He was like cutting some salami or whatever you do in a New Jersey deli.
Seriously?
Yeah. And she came in with like one of my dad's best friends at the time, Frank. And my dad like saw my mom and he was like, I got to get this lady away from Frank. That was like the first, that was the main goal. And then like whatever happened afterwards, like just like.
As long as she's away from Frank.
Totally. Yeah, Frank. It's insane, man.
Cool.
Yeah. Yeah, man.
That's strangely similar.
Yeah, like, a little bit.
Subway and a deli are pretty close.
Very, both are very dirty and like just have a smell.
Yeah.
Not good or bad. Just like there's a faint odor that's like very identifiable.
Yeah. Deal meats.
Yes.
For no reason. Like you can, everything that a deli does and everything that a Subway does, you could do.
Yeah.
On your own. But there they are.
Yeah, man. It's quite the parallel.
Interesting. Yeah. How old are your parents, if you don't
mind? Oh, they're in the...
Or ballpark.
They're like... I think my mom's... They're both in their like early 60s.
Early 60s, for sure. Okay. I was going to be surprised if they had a large age difference, because my parents have a very large age difference.
What's the age difference?
I want to say it's 11 years? I'm not sure, which is a huge age difference to me. But I guess was way more common back in that time. So.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Ferris, tell me about your first job you've ever held down.
What counts as held down and what counts as first job? So
but just go with your instinct.
The first place I would say I worked was my parents' coffee shop. Because I definitely worked while I was there. Started like bussing tables and stuff like that when I was probably around 12, and then started making food and then started doing drinks and stuff like that after that. But you know, it's your family's business. I didn't get paid. So I don't know if I would count it as a first job. And then held down, I don't know either, because my first like job out of college, that's what I would call my first real job probably. I was a civil engineer And I found it incredibly boring, and I got fired. So
it's a rough way to go out. How did that happen?
Yeah, I don't know if I would say that I held it down. I was there for a little less than 2 years.
But how did you get fired from that job, Ferris?
Horrible malpractice.
Really?
No. Jeez. No, it was like right at the beginning of COVID. I think they kind of just needed to get rid of people because they fired more people after that. But they said I was not efficient enough, which is fair because I did not like the job, so I probably wasn't very efficient. But I found out some juicy gossip.
Oh, sure.
A few years later, recently actually. So they had been like trying to get people to be more efficient, like they were kind of wanting to pay people less and stuff like that for a while. And I was fired during that time. Only to find out that one of the owners of the company had been not embezzling, but basically stealing money from the company.
Wow.
And she was the one that was trying to like drive stuff down a lot. So it's like, well, probably because you were stealing from the company.
It's a classic lady move too. Just like
classic lady move.
Classic lady move, man. stealing money from the company. Yeah.
Well, she had her husband on the payroll as like a security advisory or something like that, and all he ever did was like refill the snack dispenser thing. And then her daughter was on the payroll too, and I mean, we never even met her, never saw her, she was never there. So the other owners did not know that they were on the payroll for like six figures, and were quite upset, as I understand it, to find that out.
Interesting.
Yep. Yeah. So I feel a little bit like I knew it. I knew there was something, but I probably also was just not very good at that job.
It's a little bit of both, for sure.
Yeah, a little bit of both. How about you? What was your first job?
I was a dog groomer.
Really?
Yeah, man.
I didn't know that.
Grooming the poodles.
Yeah.
Giving them an old fashioned trim. You know.
Like, yeah.
It was pretty fun. I quit. Like I had a. Like I hated the job because it's like you smell like dog hair, but it's just like wet dog
constant. Hair.
Never, it's like leaves your nose, it's just like constantly haunting you. But with that said, Ferris, I was like washing a dog once, and then I was like going to dry it, and the dog just like pooped everywhere. He took a shit on me, like let's be honest here, and just like
metaphorically covered, and physically,
yes. Mm. And I was just like covered in the shit. And Judy looks at me, and I'm like, Judy, I gotta go outside. She was like, okay, and then like hours later, after I came back in, it wasn't quite hours, but like half hour later, it was like I came in and just like finished up my stuff, and Judy just like the way she looked at me, she was like, I know you hate this job, I won't, like, you don't have to come here anymore. And then we just like ended it. It was only like part-time.
It was somewhat mutual. Yeah, like
pretty much.
Wow. What do you think is the best kind of dog to groom?
I love a Labradoodle, like very classy dogs. Nice. Yeah.
How about the worst kind of dog?
It's gotta be
the ones that poop on you.
Yeah, exactly. What about you?
I've had two dogs in my life, that were great. We groomed them and they were schnauzers. So they had a lot of fur on their paws. Mm-hmm. So whenever we groomed them, they would have the little like very skinny legs, but with big furry paws sort of deal. And it was very cute, but that's they did nice. Hate the water. So
interesting.
Hard just to like groom a cat. Them. Yeah,
man.
Yep. We have yet to give our cat a bath. I think they're cleaner. They generally clean themselves, mm-hmm. but, sometimes I want to do it just out of spite because she's mean sometimes. So it's like, this is a thinly veiled punishment. You need to be cleaner, but also you're mean. So
yeah. For sure. What's with the cats that bark like dogs? You know what I mean? Like,
no.
Have you ever seen that?
No. Is that a thing?
I think so. I've seen videos. It might be fake, but just like, it's pretty weird. I have to show you afterwards, but
you're gonna have to show me. The only memory I have of a cat that barks like a dog is actually from a Disney princess movie.
Wow.
That my sister watched on repeat when she was younger. And I still have some of the songs from that movie just living rent-free in my head. And there was a dogish cat that barked in that movie. So maybe that's where it came from.
Maybe.
It was birthed by Disney.
It was breeded through a Disney film.
I mean, they do a lot of weird experiments.
Yeah, man.
They freeze Walt Disney, and they breed the dogish cats.
It's both very concerning.
It's what the man doesn't want you to know.
Yeah, man. Ferris, tell me a story from childhood. Tell me your first memory.
Oh.
Your first memory of, you know, living in your skin.
First memory. Honestly, I don't think about my childhood very much. So I feel like a lot of my early childhood memories that are going to come back to me are the things that have, like, scarred me. I do have one memory of my older brother tickling me, and he wouldn't stop tickling me. And so I'm on my bed, and he's, like, on me tickling me, and I get both my feet under him. And I do like a donkey kick sort of deal and just like send him flying. And his head hits the desk and like cracks on the corner of a desk. And I remember that because it was like kind of traumatic because I was like, yeah. Oh no, I broke my brother.
Yeah.
But also,
like, I didn't have to get a lobotomy after that. Just like,
yeah.
Straight up.
But also, it was like triumph. Like, I was like, yeah, I told you to stop tickling me and now I got you. So. What's up?
You came out as the victor.
Yeah, I came out as the victor. Like, a primal part of me, I guess, remembers that memory. And I was like, yeah, don't tickle me.
Well, wow. If Ferris's brother is watching this, you heard it straight from the horse's mouth.
You ever tickle me again?
Yeah.
I hope you learned. How about you?
It doesn't matter.
Early childhood.
It doesn't
matter. No?
It's all a blur. Except for a couple of traumatic experiences with my uncle. But, like, besides it. No, I'm kidding. I'm sorry. We shouldn't joke about that. That's serious.
Yeah.
But no, really. No, I'm kidding. I'm sorry.
Yeah. No, it's hard to remember stuff from childhood, honestly.
For sure.
It really is.
For sure.
Nope. I just was talking to a coworker the other day about dollar coins, and this is kind of an early childhood memory as well. I was probably like 12 or 13 at the time, but I don't remember very far back, so I would say it's an early childhood memory. We were talking about dollar coins, you know, like the little gold dollars. And I was telling him, like, you know, I was a real piece of crap as a teenager, you know, middle school or high schooler. I was a real piece of crap. And my dad had this tin that he kept by his bedside full of gold dollars. And I knew that, and I was like, I'm going to take a couple gold dollars and buy myself a soda or a snack or whatever.
Wow.
And I did that. Yeah. I, you know, stole some of his gold dollars to do that. Only to find out later.
It was actual gold.
I believe he was keeping those gold dollars because they had like a defect or something. And they were worth like way more than $1. So he had like a little tin of these that I think were worth actually a lot more than $1. And I went and like put them in a vending machine or something.
Oh my God.
And I don't know if I've ever actually told him that I did that. I kind of don't have the heart.
You don't want to find out on this podcast. That would be a bad way of finding out.
I'm going to be like, hey, watch this podcast I was on, Dad. Also, we got to talk.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't think I've ever, like, stole anything of my dad's because I was, like, too afraid of him, like, killing me.
Yeah.
Like, whacking me. Throwing me somewhere in the woods. But there was a time in my life where he accused me of stealing this incredibly expensive, it's like a cash holder, like, you know,
like a money clip.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it was gold with diamonds.
Oh.
Lots of diamonds and very, very expensive piece.
Oh,
and no. he like misplaced it one day and he like went to go look at it and just like revel in that he owns this money clip.
Yeah.
And he was like, where did it go? And he was like, no, you fucking hocked my money clip. And I was like, this isn't the 50s. You can't be just like thrown out hocked. Like, you hocking my shit. But I was like,
how old were you?
I was like 15, 14. So not even that long ago. Not even that long ago, my father was like, he's a fucking fucking piece of shit. I don't know. It's like,
how are you getting to the, I guess, pawn shop?
Yeah. Seems oh, like yeah. I'm just walking. I'm just walking 20 miles to the pawn, nearest pawn shop in Farmville. Yeah. Oh, that's what I do on my Thursdays, yeah. Man. But that really, like, I got offended, and then I was like, well, at least he thought about me.
Yeah. Like,
so
at least I came to mind.
Yeah, right?
Yeah.
That's all that counts.
Man, that's pretty unfair. I did steal my dad's things.
Yeah, and you did not accuse
me of stealing his things.
I didn't steal my dad's things, and he accused me to the utmost degree.
I think if my dad ever comes to me, and he's like, mm-hmm. hey, I had these gold dollars. There used to be more of them, I'm pretty sure. Do you know what happened to him?
Does he still own the gold dollars?
I think so.
Oh, wow. So he hasn't even, like, noticed.
Yeah, not that I know of.
But how old were you? You were, like, 11?
I want to say I was, like, 12 or 13.
Okay, 12 or 13.
But what I'm learning from this is if he ever comes to me and asks me about him, I'm going to tell him you did it. Because that's more believable.
That's pretty believable. Yeah. Wow, Ferris. That's really...
I'm sorry to dig into a wound.
No, man. That's okay. Existed. It's okay. I'm holding up here. I'm holding up. That's not even the first time my dad yelled at me. The first, like, real one that just, like, comes to mind and definitely, like, affected my personality from then on was my father used to own a restaurant, Rosaldi's, and mm-hmm. It was, like, working in the back as a kid,
yeah.
being a dishwasher.
Yes.
You know, same, very similar to you.
Yes.
And, one day I was like near the cash register and like it was like my brother Daniel or like my brother Jay was like, you know, at the cash register, yada yada. It was like underneath the cash register and there was like this fire extinguisher and I was like looking at it, just kind of like examining it, not really pressing any buttons on it, but just like looking at it.
Yeah.
I pull the pin out. I press the fucking thing. Sorry, Ferris. And then just like smoke just comes up from the air. Well, and then
was the restaurant in operation at the time?
Yes. Like,
was it open?
Yes,
it was open. And you let off the fire extinguisher?
Yeah.
That's priceless.
And people just ran out with like no explanation.
Probably thought there was a fire.
Yeah, probably thought there was a fire and they were like, oh, we don't need to hear the alarms.
Yeah,
they're spraying it already. Yeah. And all I just hear is, like, from the smoke, I don't see anybody, but I just hear, no one! Like, it's, like, forever ringing in my ears. That was really intense. And that's something wow. I did do to my father. Yeah. So, and maybe we don't know why Rosaldi's closed, but maybe that had something to do with it. Maybe that was, like, a small,
that was
like,
seed.
Yeah. Hmm. Yeah, man.
Wow. Are your parents still in the restaurant? Business now.
What
do they do now? If you don't mind me asking.
Sure. My dad lays tile okay. for like a living.
Cool.
Because he hates the fact that I destroyed his restaurant. And
so does he also hates tile and he does it spitefully?
Yes.
Okay.
Exactly. Very spitefully.
Every tile.
You gotta see.
Damn it, Noah.
You gotta see the way he lays his tile down, Ferris. It's very intentionally.
Muttering.
Yes. It's very intentional.
Like when they do, you know, some like bathroom tiles and stuff, yeah. It's a pattern of a bunch of different colors
yeah.
and stuff like
yeah,
that.
Yeah.
Is hidden in every single floor, just a little like damn you, Noah.
Yeah.
Just like spelled out with tiles.
Oh, wow.
And you'll only see it if you look really close and you know just
if only you laid it down and like really know the tile.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We should look at his previous work and
yeah.
see. I'll bet it's in there. A little Easter egg.
A little Easter
just
egg.
Just for you, everyone.
From my father. From my father. From my father.
Well, you know, people do latte art
yeah.
and stuff like that.
My dad does tile
yeah.
hate pieces on yeah. me.
My dad does the same just with latte art.
Oh, interesting.
It's like, damn it, Ferris. Why couldn't you be a doctor?
Wow. Interesting.
Yeah. Well, it's striking how similarities in our childhoods.
Yeah.
It's weird.
Yeah. It's very weird.
How many siblings do you have?
I have 5 siblings.
Okay. I only have 2. So there's not that. But
which one? What other one did you meet? Oh, did you meet Sarah? Oh, you did at Uptown, right?
Sarah?
Sarah, my sister.
I don't know if I did. Does she work at Uptown now?
No.
Okay.
No.
Okay.
Yeah.
No, I'm not sure. Maybe I did.
But you meant Jason.
Oh, at a comedy night. Was it at a comedy night?
Yes.
Yes, I think I met Sarah then. Okay. Yes. And yes, I definitely met Jason.
Yeah.
Yes. Looking at you, Jason.
Yeah. So, Ferris, yeah. Where are we at? We're only at 25 minutes.
Only 25 minutes. Wow. All right. Well, let's delve into another topic
here. Okay, sure, man.
Anything pressing on your heart or your mind or your soul?
Wow. Let's talk about Joe Biden.
Okay.
No, we don't. Let's not talk about Joe Biden. We shouldn't.
Donald Trump.
Yes. No. Let's not talk about Donald Trump. Let's talk about... Let's talk about free will versus predestination.
Oof. Okay.
Ferris. And you go because you're totally on this.
Okay. All right.
What do you believe in? And why?
I believe in free will. Okay. Let's preface all this.
Sure.
This is coming from a Christian perspective. A lot of people have a lot of different perspectives. I'm sure if you're an atheist, you would probably believe in free will, I would say. I think it would be wild. Well, I don't know. I'm not going to assume anything about anyone's beliefs. This is coming from a Christian perspective, saying, all right, God made the world. He knows everything. And what does that mean for us, basically? I would say we are given free will, for sure. And I have recently, through the debating with friends, I have come to an understanding of how predestination could also be true, but I would give it certain caveats. Basically, if you're going to call predestination, knowledge of something before it happens, then I would say that that's true. You know, like, so if you're operating under the assumption God knows everything, and he makes decisions as far as how the world was made and what goes into it and stuff like that, then yes, he did, in that sense, he determined every single action that comes about. But to me, that doesn't say that you don't have free will. I would say knowledge is different than direct choosing, a direct forcing of a will, I guess I would say. What would you, where are you kind of falling on that?
I'm a free will kind of guy.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't have like strong opinions about it, but I'm like, it's probably like, so it would make sense that it would be like free will versus like predestination.
I feel like we have to have free will.
Yeah.
Otherwise, what was the point?
Yeah.
You know, like, I'm not going to pretend.
People aren't, like, damned to hell.
Right. Right.
Like, from birth, yeah.
I don't see the point. And I mean, if you're going to say, all right, some people are going to hell, and God knows everything, then yes, he would know which people are going to end up going to hell. But that's not the same thing as saying, all right, this guy was born, I will now force him to go to hell. That's a very important distinction, I would say.
Yeah.
And I'm not a biblical scholar. There's a lot of, like I was just reading actually a portion of 2 Timothy today where they reference, I believe Paul references the elect, which is something I have heard before in kind of predestination arguments, as like the elect are the ones that God chose to go to heaven, and those are the only ones that go to heaven. That was my understanding of it. And you can kind of interpret that in different ways. The words the elect are definitely used, but that doesn't really necessitate any of those other arguments, I don't think. Mm-hmm. But you know, there's a lot of evidence for a lot of different things.
Yeah, 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 for sure.
I just don't think there would be a point if we did not have free will. Like,
yeah,
Nikola Tesla called humans meat machines, because he believed that basically everyone has a certain genetic makeup, a certain, you know, there's a direct input. So like, if you said, hey, Ferris, choose option A or option B, if you knew everything about me, you could predict every time which one I'm going to choose, A or B. And that kind of gets rid of my sense of free will in that case. If I'm just a machine, a collection of processes that deal with an input and then always have a certain output from that, then, you know, what's the point? Don't really have a sense of free will in that case. And Nikola Tesla was very smart, but don't agree with that philosophy personally. Mm-hmm. And I think that's kind of what the whole predestination, we don't have a sense of free will thing says. Is that where meat machines of a sort?
Interesting. Yeah. Yeah, man. Well,
there's a lot of interesting stories about Tesla and Edison, and they were very brilliant people, but also very flawed people. Edison was like a megalomaniac, apparently, and Tesla was absolutely insane during certain times of his life. So, yeah, everybody's good at something. Everyone's horrible at something.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think we can agree with that.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's pretty good. Pretty good, like, middle ground to come, you know, come upon.
Yeah.
Is it come? Yeah. Anyways, Ferris, with that said, do you have any closing statements for today?
What would you say should be a closing statement? Like a piece of advice?
Just go with your guts.
Or just...
Go with your guts.
I would say...
Anything to wrap up before you leave?
If I could just say something to the world that's out there, I would say ignore your pride and follow what you believe.
Okay, well...
That's my best advice that I would just give to the world.